Good morning, everybody. Happy Friday. We have an amazing show for everybody today. What do we have, Krystal?
Indeed, we do. We got a great friend of the show, Matt Stoller, to talk about the bailout. I don't know if you follow him on Twitter, but he's been kind of going off, so he should be good on that. This is like area of intense expertise. He was. Rachel Bovard, also from the right, has a great critique of the bailout as well, so we'll talk to her too. And we have Richard Hooker. He is with Teamsters Local in Philadelphia, talking about the conditions that UPS workers are having to deal with right now. Of course, for some workers, they're laid off entirely. For other workers, they're completely slammed and put on the front lines in many ways that are unsafe for them. So we'll talk to him about that as well. But we are taking a look at that stimulus bill, and we're getting new details, Saagar, about how this all came together, how the negotiations happened, and how we ended up where we are right now.
Yeah, the negotiation part is very interesting. Just a quick update for everybody, though. It will be voted on sometime in the voted on is a difficult. We don't know the exact mechanism. They could pass it through unanimous consent or whatever in the House of Representatives today. They think they'll be able to hit quorum, which is a majority of members, 216, which way they can vote on it, and it's expected to pass. And then everybody takes a break for 3 weeks, because that's what Congress does.
Disgusting.
But in terms of how the thing came together, it's of course that they had to start on the Senate side, because that's where most of the cheap objections came to be. A lot of the inside baseball from the New York Times focuses on Chuck Schumer. And the chief objection of Schumer was the $500 billion slush fund, right? And they said that there was too much discretion given over to the Treasury Secretary, so they just had to put in the same kind of TARP-like mechanisms, which is an inspector general and all of that. They never focused entirely on whether the amount was too big, on whether their payments should be larger,
on whether these things should be tied together at all.
Right, and that was the main, that's really the mystifying thing. And look, I think we're going to get into this with Matt Stoller, but a lot of people on the right, who I personally know, have huge objections to this corporate bailout, were not willing to speak up because they had to fight so hard just to get the payments. And that shows you how Schumer and McConnell really pulled this off, is that the leadership of both parties tied the corporate stuff to the direct payments.
Right.
And the populace had to spend all their energy trying to get the payments as high as possible, and so ended up having to fold on the corporate
ones. I think that's right. Yeah. I mean, you had Hawley and others on the right who were pushing for the payments to not be regressive and to be higher. You had Bernie and others on the left who were pushing for that unemployment insurance to be generous enough. And then once they got provisions...
And then Marco on the small businesses.
On small businesses. Yeah. And so once they got those provisions that were significant and important to them and battles that they had won on those little details, I think they felt like they sort of had to go along with the corporate slush fund. It's very telling to me what it was that Schumer wanted and pushed for in exchange for, you know, it's still a massive corporate slush fund. In fact, it's not $500 billion. It's really $4 trillion, as we've been discussing here. Most of the provisions are, frankly, sort of pathetic. Like, Inspector General, okay, great. So we can get a report after the fact on how they looted the Treasury? Fantastic. Better than no oversight? Okay. But still no real strings attached. Nothing really particularly onerous or burdensome on any of these corporations, many of whom, as we've covered, don't really need the money, in all likelihood. And also a provision to say, you know, Donald Trump can't use this money for his hotels, which is like perfect hashtag resistant stuff. Meanwhile, there's a massive tax loophole. It's one of the most expensive tax loopholes in this bill that will benefit real estate developers. So, you know, they get the headline and the sort of cover at the shallow level of this isn't going to benefit Donald Trump. But ultimately, there's still another tax giveaway that could benefit him. And honestly, of all the things to be concerned about, like, I don't like his grift either, but I'm much more concerned about $4 trillion to corporations versus the piddling amounts to small business owners and individual humans. There was one piece that he got that was significant, which is more money to hospitals. Important, essential at this point. There, many of them are saying that they could have to close their doors because they can't do the elective surgeries, plastic surgeries. That's like the cash cow for them, since our whole healthcare system is based around profit motives rather than actually caring for sick people. But given that that is where we stand, that was an important provision to get. Most of this, though, was just sort of like, honestly, symbolic window dressing.
Well,
Democrats, remember, Democrats killed this bill twice. And I thought, good, like, they're actually going hard on this. They're actually going to put some stuff in here that makes a difference, that matters. They're actually going to cut down the corporate slush fund. I can't believe I was so naive.
Well, I feel the same way. And actually, the hospital bailout is really the perfect thing of kind of what I'm talking about, but from a left perspective, which is that they say they have all this criticism, like in terms of the supply chain provisions that I wanted,
right,
of hospitals, of the hospital system, of profit. But when it came time, they bailed them out to the tune of, I think, $150 billion, something, $130 billion, something like that. Did they have to change the way that they make money and bill you and everybody else? No. They still get to continue being criminals and charging people outrageous sums of money, coordinating with insurance companies, consolidating across America and jacking healthcare prices up for everybody else. They don't have to change a single dime in their behavior. I bet you hospital administrators are going to get richer off of this plan than they ever were before, because now, guess what? They get to continue. They get to actually treat sick people, keep the money that they need, and then they'll go right back to plastic surgery and nose jobs and all the other stuff that actually pays their, and then overcharging people with high deductibles for X-ray, you know, like a basic X-ray costs like $9,000.
And creating these like art galleries and
these, like,
you know,
fake
Zen
things.
Gardens
right.
and whatever to attract a high-end clientele.
So there you go. We extracted. Hospitals don't have to change the way that they do business, even though the fact that they can't make money off taking care of sick people is insane. Corporations don't have to change their behavior in terms of having all their supply chain exist in China and the fact that it leaves us vulnerable here. They don't have to change much of their behavior whenever it comes to stock buyback. Nobody, all the most irresponsible actors in our system get completely bailed out. And individuals and small businesses who did nothing wrong, nothing, right? The government literally forced them to close and forego their wages are not getting bailed out to the tune that they need to.
Right.
So the most responsible people, the people who go to work every day, the people who opened a restaurant in the hope that they might be able to eke out an independent American dream, if that still exists in this country,
right,
they get nothing.
Right.
And these hospital crooks and then these corporations with all their supply lines in China, everybody just keeps to keep going.
Yep, and the system persists, and in fact, they've doubled
down. It's going to get stronger.
That's exactly right. And I think that's a piece that people really need to understand of why we're so exercised about this. It's about the present moment, but it's also about what are you going to get out of this crisis? Like, where are we going to be after this crisis? And just like in 2008, it's not going to be like with the New Deal where we broaden the middle class, we create a social safety net that helped to buoy everyone, the individual American. This is going to be another push towards massive consolidation that crushes small businesses, gives workers no power because they have to work for one of these giant, essentially, monopolies, and that's where you are. It's also, you know, it's exposed is the word I think we keep using through all of this, how stupid the healthcare debate in the Democratic primary really was. We had 3.3 million Americans who were laid off from their jobs and filed unemployment claims last week. And so how do you think that employer-based health insurance program is working out for them now? Mm-hmm. And think of this debate that we've been having about, we don't want to take away people's health insurance, as if people had some steady and stable claim to their health insurance in the current system. This exposes they do not. You have millions now who are going to be, if they had health insurance to start with, are now going to be kicked off of their employer-issued health insurance. This bill did nothing to help those people to be able to gain health insurance. It doesn't even cover coronavirus treatment. Like, even if you get sick with coronavirus, they say that you'll be able to get a test for free. Great. But you're not going to be able to get treatment. You're going to be thousands of dollars out of pocket.
This highlights another thing which really bothered me about the bill, which is at the end of the day, guess what? What are the things that we've talked about here? We all know. How are we going to get out of lockdown? Well, the only way is more testing, is being able to do quarantines, social contacting, tracing, and rapid testing is something that we just don't have yet in this country. Where was the money in the bill in order to fund testing, right? In order to fund a response. Where's the money for masks for all of our healthcare providers? That's not in there. It's all the stuff that's in there. That's like phase four. Shouldn't it be like phase one?
Yeah,
trying to get money.
After they take a month vacation. Yeah.
And this, it's all about priorities. Bail out the corporations, bail out these hospitals. And at the same time, you know, there are biotech companies out there who are trying to work on this stuff who don't have FDA approval. Shouldn't that be one of the things that Congress is concerned about? I mean, just the priorities of this country are so out of whack whenever it comes to Congress. They show who their true masters were. And I think that's why it bothers both of us so much.
So much. And I know you're covering this in your radar today, but it says everything that you can have a stock market that goes through the roof.
The highest day since 1933 during the Great Depression.
On the same day that 3.3 million Americans, we find out they filed for unemployment insurance. It tells you everything about the messed up priorities in this country with regards to our economic system that you would, you know, those top line numbers. This is something we've been talking about on this show for a long time. GDP growth, even, you know, and stock market performance has nothing to do with the lives of average Americans. As you know, we've been asking you all to submit rising stories to share what has happened to you and your life because of the coronavirus crisis. We wanted to put up one response now, if we could, on the screen. This is from Erica. She says, "Hey guys, my partner and I both lost our jobs earlier this month. We have no health care, had to cancel our wedding in April. We are not getting all our money that we already spent. Hoping we all get through this." And Erica, we are hoping that very much for you and your partner as well. And again, these are the people that aren't having their voices heard in this town. And you can tell
Erica
that by the
doesn't
priorities.
Get her money back because the hotels are greedy and all that. She doesn't get her money back on the deposits. Everybody here, all these crooks we're just talking about, they get all their money back.
They get all.
That's how it works.
They get it all. Yeah. Whatever they want. All right, we're going to tell you what's on our radars. That's next.